A couple of years ago, I made a video based on a scientific paper from a team at Potsdam University in Germany, led by the climatologist and oceanographer Stefan Ramsdorf. That research found that the Gulf Stream and Atlantic Overturning Meridional Circulation, or AMOC, had slowed down by about 15% since the middle of the last century. A collapsing AMOC was, of course, the main feature of the Hollywood blockbuster The Day After Tomorrow, which in true Hollywood style exaggerated the consequences out of all proportion and had the whole of North America under several feet of ice within about 48 hours. That impossibly rapid pace of change is thankfully not going to happen, but it is perfectly true to say that the AMOC circulation has collapsed before. In fact, it's collapsed several times over the course of Earth's long history, and records show that when it happens, it does have a very significant impact on global weather patterns. In an attempt to better understand why our global ocean circulation appears to be slowing down again now, and whether it might grind to a complete halt in the near future, scientists have been searching for evidence of what caused previous collapses of the system to establish whether those same phenomena are happening today. And now one group has published their findings in a new scientific paper. So what's going on? Is it us with our climate warming greenhouse gas emissions, or is it a completely natural process that would have happened anyway? And if the AMOC system is collapsing, how quickly will it happen? And what will be the consequences? So many questions and so little time. So let's dive straight in. Hello, and welcome to Just Have a Think. So what is the AMOC then anyway? Well, Atlantic means, well, it means it's in the Atlantic. Meridional is just a fancy word for southern or southerly, so that tells us a bit about its direction. Overturning refers to different layers of ocean water rising and sinking below each other, depending on their relative temperature and salinity, and circulation is hopefully pretty self-explanatory. Over in the Gulf of Mexico, the water is really very warm indeed, about 24 degrees Celsius or 75 degrees Fahrenheit, and it's moving at a decent pace too, about 6 miles or 10 kilometers an hour, shifting more water every second than all of the rivers in the world combined. That warm water comes across the Atlantic towards Europe, and as it does so, some of its heat is lost to the atmosphere through evaporation. The result of that is that temperatures in my part of the world are, on average, about 10 degrees Celsius warmer than areas at the same latitude across the pond. But evaporation only liberates water, it doesn't take any of the salt. That means the concentration of salt in the remaining current of water increases along the way. Eventually, the warm, salty water hits the cold, fresh water below the Arctic Circle, and because it's denser, it sinks and gets caught up in the deep southerly currents that carry it all the way south, around Antarctica, across into the Indian and Pacific Oceans, and eventually back up to the Gulf again as part of the global thermohaline circulation. It's a process that ensures the waters and essential nutrients in our oceans are continually mixed and that heat energy is distributed around the planet. It's a torturous journey though. A whole circuit can take up to 1,000 years to complete. AMOC is a big driver of the overall system, so if it slows down or grinds to a halt, then the consequences aren't local, they're global. Climatologists and oceanographers like Stefan Ramsdorf tell us that climate change is indeed having an effect on the AMOC system. As we've discovered in previous videos here on the channel, human-induced greenhouse gas emissions and Arctic amplification mean that the Arctic is warming at a much faster rate than the global average. That warming is melting ice from the Arctic Ocean and from the Greenland ice sheet, vastly increasing the amount of fresh water in the surrounding seas. As the water freshens and becomes less salty, it gets less dense and therefore less likely to sink and join up with the deep cold currents, and that slows down the AMOC system. This paper, published in 2018, found that right now AMOC is the weakest it's been for about 1600 years. A more recent study, published in July 2022 by teams at the University of Bremen in Germany and the University of Sao Paulo in Brazil, analysed sediment cores from water almost 2,000 metres deep at a site to the east of Newfoundland in the subpolar western North Atlantic. Those sediment cores hold hidden information going back thousands of years. Layers and layers of plankton build up over those millennia to provide a chronological database of ocean conditions, a bit like the rings of a tree can reveal what the weather was like in each growth season. In this case, the scientists studied the ratio of magnesium to calcium in a species of plankton with the spectacular name of Neoglobo-Quadrina Pachyderma sinistral, or N. Pachyderma sin, going back 250 years at a time, over 27,000 years. And through the clever jiggery-pokery that modern-day science allows, They use this data as a proxy for historical subsea surface temperatures down to depths of about 150 meters. But N. pachydermis syn also contains a stable oxygen isotope called delta O18, which can be used as a proxy for ocean salinity over the same period. So now the team had a comprehensive record of ocean temperature and salinity going back far enough to span periods of previous AMOC collapses. The data demonstrated that warming of the waters at high latitudes of the North Atlantic closely corresponded to times of a weakened AMOC and preceded a massive release of an armada of icebergs from Canada and the US into the Atlantic, which caused enormous freshening of the surrounding waters, resulting in the rapid and total collapse of the AMOC system. As I mentioned earlier in the video, we already know that the AMOC system is weakening again now, and we know that the main drivers this time around are an overall warming of the planet's surface and a much more rapid warming of ocean water at high latitudes, causing more intense rainfall, all of which is being turbocharged by human-induced greenhouse gas emissions. The warmer water is melting and destabilizing glacier sea snouts in Greenland, which is accelerating the release of enormous volumes of fresh water into the ocean as the melting of the Greenland ice sheet speeds up. In other words, we humans have rapidly created very similar conditions up in the subpolar regions that caused a massive release of icebergs thousands of years ago. Scientists are not projecting an imminent collapse of the AMOC system, but it is potentially a bit too close for comfort. A 2019 article from the UK Met Office found that while a total AMOC shutdown this century is very unlikely, it does remain a possibility. They also say that if the world started taking urgent steps to properly mitigate climate change, then the weakening could be slowed or even reversed. But of course, we humans are a curious bunch, aren't we? And scientists have been debating the consequences of an AMOC collapse on modern day society for some time now. In June 2022, another research paper was published that took an in-depth look at those consequences. It was produced by researchers from the University of New South Wales, and it used very sophisticated model simulations that suggested there would be abrupt changes reaching far beyond the Atlantic basin and Northern Hemisphere, stretching right around the globe. In what they call the AMOC off scenario, the researchers found that cooling in the North Atlantic would extend southwards, reaching the northern mid-latitudes within the first 10 years after shutdown, and the tropical Atlantic by year 20, largely as a result of sea surface wind evaporation. The model also showed cooler sea surface temperatures creeping into the higher latitudes of the North Pacific by around year 5, becoming well established by year 20. That North Pacific cooling would eventually cause sea ice to expand in the ocean basin, which would reinforce the cooling as a result of the extra sea ice reflecting the sun's energy back into space via what's known as the albedo effect. By about year 30, the model showed that cooling would start happening in the equatorial Pacific, evolving that region into more permanent La Niña-like conditions. We took a closer look at the effects of a sustained La Niña quite recently. Suffice to say, they're not great, especially for countries like Australia and Africa. Then there's the shutdown of a crucial movement of heat from the southern hemisphere to the northern hemisphere via the great thermohaline circulation that I mentioned earlier. With that switched off, most of the ocean heat stays down south, with the biggest contrast between southern and northern ocean temperatures occurring after about 3 decades. To compensate for the lack of oceanic heat transport, nature turns to the atmosphere in an attempt to balance global temperatures. There's a strengthening of something called Hadley cells in the northern hemisphere, which are pockets of warm air that rise at the equator and move towards the poles. Hadley cells also create the trade winds, tropical rain belts, hurricanes, and the jet stream. So as they get stronger, all those events become more extreme as well. The study even demonstrated AMOC connections to atmospheric circulation over the West Antarctic, with indications that the greater retention of ocean heat in the region would bring about an accelerated melting of the ice sheet, with all the catastrophic consequences of sea level rise that I'm sure we're all aware of. Now, there's a big caveat here, and that's that the research team concede that these results were derived from only a single computer model that was set up under pre-industrial conditions. They suggest future work should examine the impacts of an AMOC shutdown under a range of scenarios that take into account increasing atmospheric greenhouse gas concentrations. So once again, we find that the accuracy of climatic predictions are only as good as the models we base them on, which means there's still a lot of variation in the detail. But one thing all the models agree on is that an abrupt AMOC collapse would bring about profound changes to the oceanic and atmospheric systems that all life forms on Earth rely on. Nature's got all the mechanisms needed to recalibrate back to equilibrium over geological timescales, of course, so dear old planet Earth will quite happily trundle along for another few billion years or so, regardless of any undulations in the cycles of its control systems. The threat of AMOC collapse is not to the planet, it's to all the species that live on the planet, including we humans. All the indications are that if and when the AMOC does shut down, it will happen very quickly, with consequences kicking in with only a few years, making it almost impossible for an entire global society to adapt in time to avoid catastrophic consequences. Alternatively, we could start taking climate science seriously, stop wasting time in pointless international talking shops, and immediately implement globally agreed actions to eradicate the combustion of fossil fuels, transform our agricultural practices, and provide support for developing nations to grow their economies in a sustainable way. So another challenging one then, folks. No doubt there are some strong views out there one way or the other, so if you feel a burning desire to share your thoughts, then the place to do that is in the comments section below. That's it for this week though. A massive thank you, as always, to our amazing Patreon supporters who help me keep these videos independent and free of ads and sponsorship messages. And I must just give a quick shout out to some folks who joined recently with pledges of $10 or more a month. They are Paul Ferguson, Robert Nistrom, Tom Fulp, David Gomez, Aidan McGrath, Eric Lutz, David Raff, and Andrew Powser. And of course, a big thank you to everyone else who's joined since last time too. If you found this video useful and informative, then make sure you subscribe to stay up to date with future programs. And if you're keen to learn more about issues and challenges like those we've looked at today, then this video is well worth a look too. As always, thanks very much for watching. Have a great week, and remember to just have a think. See you next week.